Okay, let's get into that indeed. So we're going to now turn to 1854 and the proclamation by Pope Pius IX called Infallibilis Deus, which is the proclamation that was made that it is an apostolic doctrine and a divinely revealed truth that Mary was conceived without sin. And what that means is that at the moment of her conception by an act of God's grace, they will tell you this, and this is important because we're going to get into a little bit of this later on in this podcast. But they would say that all of the benefits of Christ's death were applied to Mary at that singular instant of her conception, so that she was not only saved from her sins but saved from sinning. But it was all by the merits of the cross. And that is important because oftentimes we find Protestants will argue against Roman Catholics and say, well, Mary calls Jesus her Savior, and therefore she must have been sinful. And Roman Catholics will say, no, he saved her from sin and from sinning. And so he is her Savior. All the merits of the cross were applied to her at the moment of her conception so that it would prevent her from sinning, so that he really did save her from sinning. Now, I think that's silly because the angel told Mary that that God was going to save his people from their sins. Of course, the Roman Catholics say, well, that's a general statement, doesn't necessarily apply to Mary. But let's go into the actual proclamation here. I'm only going to pull out a small paragraph from Infallibilis Deus, and it's the point where Pope Pius IX draws on the imagery of the ark. And he says, in Speaking of all, last week we introduced the episode by talking about all the different ways that some late church and medieval church fathers saw Mary prefigured in almost everything in the Old Testament. And so Pius IX has recited that a little bit, and he says, in such allusions, the fathers taught that the exalted dignity of the Mother of God, her spotless innocence, and her sanctity unstained by any fault, in a wonderful manner. In like manner did they use the words of the prophets to describe this wondrous abundance of divine gifts and the original innocence of the Virgin of whom Jesus was born. They celebrated the August Virgin as the spotless dove, as the holy Jerusalem, as the exalted throne of God, as the ark and house of holiness which eternal wisdom built, and that as queen who, abounding in delights and leaning on her beloved, came forth from the mouth of the Most High, entirely perfect, beautiful, most dear to God, and never stained with the least blemish. Okay, so that's what happens in a proclamation like this from a pope is that he'll go through all the arguments, and one of the arguments, obviously, is that Mary was prefigured as the ark, and the ark was actually a type that points us to Mary. That is the ark of the new covenant. So what I want to get to next is say that let's read the actual proclamation from the document itself. And the proclamation is he claims, Pope Pius IX claims that this had been always taught by the church. And this is what he proclaimed in the document. And indeed, this is quoting from Pius IX, and indeed, less illustrious documents of venerable antiquity of both the Eastern and the Western Church very forcibly testify that this doctrine of the Immaculate Conception of the Most Blessed Virgin, which was daily more and more splendidly explained, stated, and confirmed by the highest authority, teaching, zeal, knowledge, and wisdom of the Church, and which was disseminated among all peoples and nations of the Catholic world in a marvelous manner, this doctrine always existed in the Church as a doctrine that has been received from our ancestors and that has been stamped with the character of revealed doctrine. For the Church of Christ, watchful guardian that she is, and defender of the dogmas deposited with her, never changes anything, never diminishes anything, never adds anything to them, but with all diligence, she treats the ancient documents faithfully and wisely. Okay, so that's Pius IX's summary statement about why it is believed and now infallibly taught, infallibly, allegedly taught by Roman Catholicism, that Mary was sinless. And it's important to remember that we're seeing all these types. We're supposed to see all these types in the Old Testament. And they're all supposed to point to Mary. And they all show that Mary was prefigured in all these things. And she was prefigured in with such a degree of holiness and by such holy articles as the tabernacle and the ark that she must necessarily be sinless. But what we're going to show is that expert Roman Catholic Mariologists acknowledge that her sinlessness does not emerge as an idea until the latter part of the fourth century, and that it was a novelty at that time when it did. I want to show you why Roman Catholic apologists have such a conundrum with Pius IX's statement that this has always been held and believed by the entire church. And what I want to do is to walk through the various church fathers' interpretation of Bible verses and show that they recognized, just as we do, that the biblical testimony shows that Mary was a sinner. And I know that sounds absolutely anathema to Roman Catholics, but remember, it's their Pope who said that all the documents, the churches from the earliest days, East and West, forcibly testify to the sinless immaculacy of Mary. And it just isn't true, and we're going to prove that today.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because the moment you said that, I sort of cringed because I was thinking, them's fighting words, you know, with Roman Catholicism.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, well, my challenge in response, if Roman Catholics think those are fighting words, then let me just tell you from the perspective of Semper Reformanda Radio that inventing history is fighting words to us. And if you want to prove that Mary's Immaculate Conception was an apostolic doctrine, then show taught by the apostles instead of coming to us with fabricated documents, forged documents, spurious documents, and highly edited documents that are changed to make the early church fathers say something they weren't saying. I mean, it's a simple request.
Amen.
Roman Catholics claim to be the guardians of the truth, and they come to us with lies and expect us to bend the knee to Rome because a lie, it's still taught by the church, and Jesus would never lead his church into error. Now, you know what? I agree with that. Jesus would never lead his church into error, and that's why we know that Roman Catholicism is not his church.